Good morning, I'm Michael from Moat Monster Gaming, and if you enjoy the video, please like and subscribe. So today I'm looking through Dungeons & Dragons Adventurer number 18. So it comes with a tin here, no surprises, it has dice inside. I actually think they're quite colourful, I think they're quite nice. Do I need them or want them? No. But they look okay, nice little symbol on that one, but dice, more dice. So let's put them to one side. So this is number 18, and the first thing I noticed that it came with this little piece of paper. So if I bring it in close, dear customer, please be aware that if you require any missing issues or binders, you can ask your newsagent or visit our e-shop. I actually felt like it seemed like a bit of desperation. I don't know how well it's selling. I certainly know I'm the only person who's picking it up from my Smiths because I'm the only one who's got it on order there because I talked to the lady and she tells me. But yeah, I don't know. It just felt like it was really trying to push getting you to get more issues. So I'll shove that onto one side. But anyway, looking through number 18, I really, really enjoyed this one. I think it's actually got lots going for it. So first of all, some sage advice. We've got role-playing villains and running mysteries. Then character creation, very druid heavy, as was the previous issue, but actually it rounds it out and completes it up to the end of second level. So that's quite good. And we have the hermit background. Then we've got some lore on monsters. And the City Watch, it doesn't actually specifically talk about any City Watch. It kind of just talks about a few of the different ones that you get in Forgotten Realms. And then we have the adventure, Infernal Affairs, which actually I thought was really, really good. So first of all, we've got role-playing villains. It's got some decent tips here. It does talk about how if you've got favourite villains in the media, actually, or media, I mean like in fiction, actually use them, use what you know. And actually, I think that's a really good tip. Don't necessarily make it obvious that you're copying, say, Skeletor or Mumra or Hans Gruber or whatever. But like, it just do use the villains that you know, and it just makes it easier. I agree with this top tip. Make them your own, but you know, lean into character tropes that you know, and even characters that you know. But it's good. It's a good first couple of pages, and I found the whole thing kind of escalated. Its advice is better in this one. Its advice is more developed. Anyway, a couple of pages on how to run mysteries, mainly because it's tying it in with the encounter at the back. It does even spoil the encounter at the back, but it does warn it here. And again, it is a DM's piece of the sage advice, not necessarily for players. It does go into who and what is going on in the encounter, but it's doing that because it's trying to get you to think about how a mystery works, why a mystery works, you know, what the crime is. Multiple persons of interest, don't just limit it to one suspect, have a pool of suspects, and then, you know, how to leave and display clues. It likens it to Poirot. Very good. Then we got the druid. So more features on the druid. Talks about wild shape, talks about how they're beast masters, and then we've got some stat blocks. It's why it's kind of split over three parts. And the first part was in the previous one, but we've got some stat blocks for some common animals that maybe the druid in your party is going to want to turn into. But obviously it's not exclusive just to this list, and it does specify that. Very, very terrifying picture of a spider here. Looks like something out of Sting. Looks like it's going to come and get someone. And then here we have the hermit background. Little bit on the hermit benefits. Obviously it ties in fairly well, hermits and druids, which is why they've, I think, chosen this background to go with it. And then we have some very nice lore on devils. I have to admit, I never really play much with devils and demons and the nine layers, But it's an interesting read. I've always tended to avoid quests that involve them because it just doesn't appeal to me. I prefer the aberrations. I prefer like mind flayers and beholders and the more kind of twisted, weird, monstrous creatures rather than these guys. But it's really well written and it's really well laid out, because over on this page, we've got this nice little box talking all about the ranks, the different rankings of, the, I suppose, the different types of demons and devils and stuff that you have in hell. It's very well done and it all makes sense. So moving on, our second lore piece is about the City Watch. It talks about the Waterdeep and the Neverwinter City Watches, but just talks about how City Watches work in general. They're not militia, they're the kind of constabulary. They're kind of trying to keep the peace inside the city, keep crime down, the police force. Here we've got a little piece on watch talk, which I thought was quite nice, a little bit of watch slang. And then a little bit here that I wasn't so sure on, which was, you know, what do you do when your players want to enlist? I've never had a player want to enlist in the City Watch, but perhaps it's more common than I think. But then, yeah, here, a little bit about what do you do and how do you, I suppose, maybe just broaden it into like a bit of a cops and robber campaign. But it gives you a couple of tips. It's all right. And then finally, we have the encounter. And I really like it. I feel like they've upped the page count ever so slightly on this one. And it's good. So we start off with this nice picture of this bookcase. It's because we're going into a like a temple of knowledge, and it revolves around, there's some fanatic, he wants a scroll, it's been stolen, but the mystery is who's stolen the scroll. So it does heavily utilize a character that was in the tavern one from a couple of issues ago, the bard. So they turn up and they are asking the players for help. He's got a couple of ideas how you can adventure hook them in. They want the players' help because they want to use the Temple of Knowledge, the library, and they can't because there's the constabulary conducting an investigation into who robbed it, who stole this special scroll. And so this person here, they're willing to pay, this bard's willing to pay the hero's coin if they go and solve the mystery, you know, on everybody's behalf, basically. Their motivations are fleshed out. I already thought they were quite a well fleshed out character two issues ago. And here we have the Temple of Knowledge, which again, I think they go into quite great detail about the why. We've got a guard in it. It talks quite heavily about the guard and what his motivations are, and then it goes into investigating, because again, because the whole one issue is about mysteries, we have them going into great detail about, you know, investigating. We've got a list of clues here which are all quite good, which they can prize out of various characters dotted about the House of Knowledge. And of course, at the same time, they're investigating, bearing in mind they shouldn't be there because they're supposed to be locked out of it because it's a police investigation. There's a chance they can bump into the chief inspector who is conducting the investigation. But then after that, they then get hopefully the clues to point them in the right direction. I mean, it is quite basic. Once the people are sort of like give up their information, the people that are there and working, it's easy to root out which person has done the crime, and then they have to go and confront him. Actually, it's not as straightforward as that, because they're doing it because they're being made to do it. So they then get pointed into the direction of this cultist residence, and it's left really open-ended. We got this lovely map here with a couple of secret locations built into it, which I thought was quite good. Secret cultish altar. There's not much going on in the locations, but there's enough description to flesh it out, and you could easily flesh it out a little bit more. It's a tiny bit of treasure, but ultimately they have to confront a villain, and a bit like Ozymandias, he's already done what he's supposed to have done. So the players are kind of almost late to the party, and he did it 15 minutes ago. And in theory, he can get away. They can still be rewarded. They can get the item back they need, Scroll of Infernal Calling. But ultimately, what he needed to do, he's already achieved, and leaves it open for another encounter. Now, I have said I am stopping at 20. I have 19 and 20 still to read and to put up. But I do hope at some point these get published and give me a chance to go back and buy them in maybe some sort of book format without all of the sage advice and stuff at the start, because actually it does sound like it's getting interesting and there is some forward planning. I was pleased to see the Bard come back, who they went into such detail with 2 issues ago. So it does feel like they're slowly bringing it together. And this one actually feels like it could be a proper adventure, whereas the first one just felt like a load of encounters strung together. And even the start of this one on the high road to Neverwinter, just a bunch of encounters strung together. Now that they're here, I really feel like they're fleshing them out, and it's a shame I'm stopping, but I've still got a couple of issues to go. I may change my mind, but basically I don't want to be buried in an avalanche of dice. But this is good and enjoyable, and if you wanted to flesh it out, you can easily. And if you don't want to flesh it out, you got everything that you need there. So we have a stat block for the bard, stat block for the cultist fanatic. And then because there's some imps involved in the battles, right on the back here, we've got stat block for the imps. But yeah, it's a good little encounter. Thank you very much for watching. Take care.